Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of IHNA IHM Career Australia. Thank you so much for your valuable feedback so far. We have received a lot of feedback for our previous episodes. Please keep watching and continue to give us your feedback. We would also like to welcome your suggestions, and also if you would like to for us to cover some particular topics, please let us know. We'll be happy to look at what are the different other topics people would like us to cover. So today we would like to talk about employment benefits in Australia. As you know, Australia is one of those countries where, you know, a lot of people would like to come live and work. And I think one of the reasons why people want to work is because of the kind of entitlements or benefits one get when they work in Australia. So as you know, Australia has got they've developed a good high standard in terms of the employment entitlements, and in terms of the legal structure, it is covered by Australian, which is Commonwealth across Australia, and also by each state and territory governments. So I wanted to give a bit of details of what are those things you would know in terms of the entitlement, so that you can expect what is that when you come to Australia and work, you can expect here. So the primarily, I wanted to first talk about what is central of this. So there are a few things which is actually the base of how entitlements are organized. So the first is national employment standards. So there are 10 national employment standards in Australia, which is actually one of the central part of it. In addition to this, there is superannuation, because Australia wants you to have a good retirement life after you work until the age of 65. 65 is the age of retirement in Australia. And there is also high safety standards. So work health and safety is a key entitlement or key policy to ensure that you have got the safer workplace. And then there is Fair Work Australia and Fair Work Ombudsman, who actually oversees whether these policies are in place and also to ensure compliance for the government. So in terms of talking about the health and safety, Australia maintains a very high health and safety standards. And in terms of when you go to any establishment, for example, it could be an IT firm or a manufacturing firm or a mining firm. Australia has got a lot of mines. Any of those different establishments, every industry has got the safety standards, so that they can ensure that the workers who are working in those environments are safe and protected. So employees or individuals' safety is a first priority, and it has been given really high importance, so that people are safe when they work in such risky environments. Sometimes, as you know, it's not the same standard. For example, an IT company may not have a lot of issues or health and safety risk compared to someone who works in mining or manufacturing. So it's not just one policy fits all. It's actually different, like in many parts of the world. It's different for each industry based on the amount of risk and also the way they operate their business. And sometimes, irrespective of all these factors, issues may come up, or people may have incidents which they may get injured. In all of such circumstances, there is a protection called workers' compensation insurance. So every organization or every company operates in Australia need to have, if they meet those minimum criteria to become a business, they actually have to have a workers' compensation insurance, so that in case if any of the staff member, they've got, injured, or if any kind of incident happens or accident happens, they actually will be covered under the workers' compensation insurance, which includes the treatment, and also it also covers the leave for the time of the treatment. Another one, a key entitlement is superannuation. So superannuation is very similar like a pension plan. So what it does is any employer, actually, whoever you work for, they actually have to have 9.5% deduction, not contribution. The employer has to contribute 9.5% of your base salary, so that it will be gone to your superannuation account, and then you know it, you will actually, and it also get the interest. So the superannuation company, so the people who manage those funds, they manage those mainly based on an investment portfolio, and then you know at the end of your retirement life, you will actually get that all money, you know, or you get the interest from that total fund. So 9.5% is employer's contribution, and if you like to contribute, you also have the ability to contribute, and that is actually in Australia, whatever you contribute, you know, I'm not 100% sure about how much is your percentage maximum you can contribute, but to a certain extent it is also a tax benefit, so you don't have to pay tax for the contribution you provide to the superannuation. So I did mention the central of this is national employment standards. So there are 10 national employment standards in Australia, and this is primarily, the first one is about maximum hours of work. So anyone who works full-time means, you know, working Monday to Friday or Monday to Saturday, that is maximum 38 hours. So it's primarily from Monday to Friday. So 38 hours is the maximum working hours of anything which goes beyond 38 hours is it attracts overtime. So you know, if someone who works more than 38 hours, they may get more payment in terms of the salary. The second employment standard is about flexible hours. So every employee working in Australia has an eligibility to or a right to ask for flexible hours, you know, because sometimes people may have different circumstances. They may have a kid to care, or you know, for example, a husband working, but they something happened with the wife, you know, they cannot manage the work and life. So if there is a reasonable request comes under the flexible policy, then the employee has the right to request for a you know, flexible work hours, and then the employer has to consider. Isn't it nice? The third one is parental leave. So parental leave is, you know, as you know, it could be both. It could be maternity or paternity, but both are eligible for parental leave. And, you know, so different places has got different leave in terms of the total duration of the leave, but there is a minimum, you know, amount of leave they have to give for parental purposes. There's also annual leave in Australia, and this is one of the most attracting thing I have found. The reason is, you know, I think it mainly 4 weeks of annual leave, and then for, you know, some places they offer 5 weeks. There are organizations offer 6 weeks, and there are also organizations who offer 7 weeks in some of the remote communities or regional areas, primarily because they don't always attract staff. So they wanted to, they use annual leave as an option to attract and retain staff. So imagine about a company you work where you have got 6 weeks of 6 or 7 weeks of leave. That itself is a huge stress relief, and now you can go anywhere. That's reasonably a good amount of leave. And I think in many of the developed countries, I don't think any country has got that much of annual leave provided. The company I work for, I normally get 6 weeks of leave, and I think that actually gives me a good amount of time to go home, you know, if I want to go overseas, and also give me opportunity sometimes to go to some other places. So it actually gives me an opportunity to travel around. There are also a number of other leave types you can avail in Australia, which is your entitlement. One is personal or carer's leave. So you are entitled to personal or carer's leave. Sometimes if it is more than 2 days, you may have to give a medical sick leave. When you take it as sick leave, you may have to provide a medical certificate for that. However, you are entitled to that, you know, just based on what each organization follows. But in general, that's one of the entitlement in the national employment standards. Another kind of leave which is not very common in other parts of the world is domestic violence leave. For example, if you have an issue at home, you know, sometimes it's not a good time for you. You are not in a good mood to work, or you know, you really have a very, you know, bad day because of some issues happened at home. Australia also give you entitlement for that, so you can actually apply for domestic violence leave or family leave, and then you are entitled to get one of those if you're eligible. Another interesting leave is the same like annual leave. I've said 6 weeks or 7 weeks long service leave. So this is not an entitlement for every year. It is more for someone who works with an organization for more than 10 years. So long service leave, in terms of accessing that leave, you can access it after 10 years. And sometimes, you know, if people leave the job after 7 years, they may have the option to get that leave paid, but not using the leave, but you know, they get paid for that leave. So long service leave is primarily, you know, when you work in a place for 10 years, you are eligible for about 13 weeks of leave, and then you can take that leave, you know, or, and then maybe after next 5 years, like after 15 years, you get another half of it. So it's a big chunk of leave. I know friends who actually take long service leave in half pay. So you have the option, for example, if you have got 13 weeks of leave, you can take it in half pay. And when you take it in half pay, it will become 26 weeks. So that means almost 6 months of leave. Isn't it nice? So that's something that the government looked at to see, because the employment conditions are changing. So people are not staying in a job for a long time. People, you know, like to move out maybe 3 years, 5 years after working in one place. But if you work long term, you know, it's something that someone's dedication and commitment to an organization, and Australia wants to recognize that commitment. That's how long service leave has been, you know, introduced. There's also an entitlement for public holidays. So if there are there is government gazetted or announced public holidays in Australia, and every employer has to give those public holidays to the staff. So it's an employee entitlement. Sometimes we think why recruitment is hard, or particularly for new migrants, why it is too tough to enter into a job in Australia. And one of the reasons could be, once you become an employee in an organization, if the employer wants to terminate you, you know, they don't want you to work for them anymore. It's not an easy task for an employer just to do it. You know, you are protected in the National Employment Standard to have a notice of termination. So you have a right for getting a notice of termination. And or if your job or role is no longer required, they also actually have to provide you redundancy pay. So, you know, saying that this role is no longer required and we have to pay you redundancy. So employers just can't, you know, make you leave. Rather, they actually have to think about it properly. And then, you know, if it's not something that you think unfairly done to you, you also have the opportunity to go to Fair Work so that they can actually look at your matter and see whether you have been, you know, dealt properly, or if there is an unfair practice, how, you know, the Fair Work will actually act on it. So that's one of the reason I think when people do recruitment or organizations do recruitment, they do a lot of thinking behind it. Primarily because of they don't want people to come, and if they are not adaptable, or the, you know, things are not working out, they don't want to go through that hurdle. The last part of it is a Fair Work statement. That is primarily, you know, all these different entitlements what I mentioned now, it is actually mentioned in a statement, in a one-page statement by Fair Work, and every employer is required to give that statement to an employee when they join the organization. It's primarily to educate staff or staff members, you know. So it's not just about Australia's put these national employment standards and then they are not communicating. Rather, they have instructed every employer that they have to educate the staff so that the staff knows what are their entitlements. So every employer has to give this Fair Work statement to the staff when they join on the first day, so that staff is actually aware of the entitlements, and then, you know, when such situation happens, they can actually make use of these entitlements. The next thing I wanted to talk to you about is different kinds of employment in Australia. So normally when we talk about employment, it's, you know, we normally think about just work, but in Australia has got different types of work. So they see it as full-time, you know, someone who works the 38 hours, and then there is part-time, someone who works maybe 3 days a week, you know, which is part-time. They are not working 38 hours, which is a full-time 5 days a week. And then there is also casual. So casual is, you know, someone who maybe required to work today, they may not require to work tomorrow. So it's a casual arrangement. You, based on the employer's need, you work for that one particular employment, and you can have different casual employment. For example, you may be working in a hospital for 2 days as a casual staff, and you may be working in another health service as, you know, casual staff for another 2 days. So it's two different casual employment. And there is also, it's not employment, but an opportunity, like you can be a contractor, you know. So that's a different arrangement. It's not an employment arrangement, but primarily you work as a contractor, so it's under a contractor agreement. So it gives you different opportunities to how you want to work with an employer. And something interesting is the minimum wages. So there is also a minimum wage in Australia, and which is for any full-time, part-time, you know, those kind of roles. It is $19.36 for an hour. And for casual, because as I said, casual is not a job which, you know, that, you know, it's casual. So that, because of that, there is a salary loading on it. So an hourly rate for casual job is $24.36, which is really, both these are good, money for someone who works. And then it's also good for people to know that these are the minimum wages. So no employers can actually employ you less than these salaries. The other question sometimes people think, when particularly when new people come to Australia, is all these compliance or laws are applicable for, or the rights are same for the new, you know, the newcomers? Yes, absolutely. The same rights for visa holders and also for new migrants. So anyone who works under, you know, whichever visa condition, it doesn't matter, or whether you have a citizenship, you hold PR or in a permanent residency, or you work on a work visa, doesn't matter. All these rights are the same for everyone under the Fair Work Act. And two other things I think I really found interesting is, which some of you might have not thought of, is secondary employment. Australia doesn't restrict you to only work in one place. So if, for example, you know, you working in an environment where you working full-time for 5 days, but you thought, you know, so for example, you're not married, you're a bachelor, so you got your weekends free, and you thought, why don't you do something else? And if it's not in conflict with your primary job, you can actually do a secondary job. There is no problem. In sometimes when you do a contract with your primary job or primary employer, what they do is they may have a clause which says that if you're going for a secondary employment, you have to let them know and declare that there are no conflicts with your secondary employment. In such cases, you need to let them know that you are working somewhere else, and then, you know, primarily it's for the safety of that organization. They don't want to see that both these jobs are colliding with each other, and then the primary employer is, you know, taking the the risk of you not being available full time because you are expected to work with the full time. So in such cases, it's always good for your primary employer to know that you have an interest working somewhere as a secondary employment, and ensuring that it is not colliding with your main job. But it is a good thing, you know. So sometimes, for example, if you have a different career interest, or you wanted to chase your habit for some money or for some career interest, the secondary employment option always give you that opportunity. And sometimes it also gives the opportunity, for example, some employers, you know, rather than you working full time, you may be interested to work only 4 days, so you move into a part-time job opportunity or part-time employment, and then you spend the Friday or, you know, Monday or Friday, whichever day, you know, you wanted to do it, you open that opportunity for a secondary employment. So it actually helps you if you do a job which it's not really your passion, but you want to try out. It gives you that opportunity to try out something else rather than quitting and then jumping into something new. And in all together, I think what this does to us is it provides a lot of work-life balance, one. Second, a very safer environment for work, and also gives a lot of from an employee perspective, it gives a lot of satisfaction and freedom, you know, a lot to choose from. So it gives you time to take a break, time to spend with your family, chase your dreams. So these entitlements, I think, is something that my background as, in the previous episodes, I said my background is in human resource, and I worked in different other parts of the world. And I think what Australia offers us in terms of this employment entitlements is absolutely amazing. You know, I cannot express how much I am happy to work in such an environment where you actually also can, from an employer's perspective, from a workplace, you know, how easy or how better it's to engage with staff, because these are the workplace rights. So these are employee rights. You know, it's not something that you can change by yourself, because it's actually protected by law. Thank you so much for watching this episode, and we will look forward to hear your feedback. If you got any feedback, you know, please write to us, and we'll be happy to hear from you and then see what other episodes we can do which is of interest to you. Thank you so much. Have a good day. Bye.